services. These are the only things that we care about. Some back-end job, it's not a problem. But if it's going to cost us, so we can equate out essentially every minute of downtime based on traffic that's coming in. We know how much each user does, the percentage of ones that click through, how much their value is worth. So we can calculate pretty finitely how much an outage costs us. So we know the more first-class services, kind of these SLAs that we have to react within 5 minutes and get somewhat fixed within 15 to 20 type thing. To facilitate this, we do a lot of like humane rotas. We have larger teams. We don't want to get in a situation where you've got just two developers working and they're just having to swap on call all the time. That's not really going to work in the long term. We also pay pretty well for it because we found in the past, and a lot of people have, trying to do it with goodwill just doesn't work out. It's eventually going to fall through. Just being like, oh yeah, I'll do on call. You know, if something happens, then I'll take a day off the next day, because there's still that mental capability of, oh, I can't really go out tonight, or if I do, I have to bring my laptop. And there's like a mental burden of being on call. So we just made the choice to pay for it up front. We're also giving time and priority fixing anything that pops up. A lot of places, and the reason a lot of people get burned by being on call is you'll keep getting woken up to the same thing over and over and over again. And that's usually what kills it. So we're given that if there's a problem, we're allowed to have the time to try and address that right away. Like whether that's adjusting an alert, realizing that was a bogus alert, maybe we don't care that it was going off, whether it's a deeper issue, we have to dig into it. And we also get to prioritize that over new features. So if we're constantly getting woken up for something, then we'll just take time to fix that instead of adding more stuff on top of it because we realize that there's a problem that needs fixed there. Some of the benefits of being on call is it like helps you focus on operability. So a lot of times that classic divide of, you know, devs and operation, building from the start, operability means, you know, knowing what metrics matter, knowing how to alert, knowing the points you can get into a system to fix it. You know, given this thing going off, this is the thing I should do. And if you're even writing that down and you start to think, well, if I'm writing it down, how can I just automate this? There's a lot of things that we do that I think just doing developer only, you kind of miss out on. And just having that empathy of knowing, okay, this is what it's like to be on call, it unlocks a lot of stuff. And it also lets us deploy whenever we want, which is a big thing. I think a lot of companies, you know, they have these release freezes around holidays, you know, maybe beyond 4 o'clock on a Friday, you know, it's like no deploy or something because you don't want to break things and you're always worried. But by knowing that you're on call, it kind of lets you make that choice and you realize the consequences of a bit more. And one of the big things a lot of companies don't do is our management is also on the escalation path. So we have, so we kind of do the tribe squad model. So the people are above squad. So it's kind of everybody below the CTO, basically. It'll escalate up. If we don't answer within, I think it's 5 or 10 minutes, it'll just go the next manager up and the next manager above that. So they are essentially on call all the time. They get called out very infrequently because somebody's always catching it. But it also gives us that confidence to know that the same thing that we can get woken up for, they could, you know, if there's a problem. So it's like not just our skin in the game, and it gives us, it kind of changes it a bit to know that, you know, they're putting that behind it, so that, you know, they're kind of incentivized in a way to let us fix these issues, so it's not just kind of hidden and pushed below the carpet, which is really good. Postmortems, we do a lot of blameless postmortems, hopefully not too many. So an outage is a great chance to learn, it's a great chance to get things fixed. And we try and focus on making sure the same class of issue isn't repeated. A lot of times in postmortems, people will say, oh, this one thing caused it. But if you dig a bit deeper, you realize, well, it's actually like a whole systemic class of issues that maybe if we change our tooling or if we change the way the system works, it could just be like a non-issue in the future, or we can find out about it faster. So we try and really dig and get some information from that. A lot of times tooling changes come from that. And not only do we focus on how do we stop things that went wrong, but then how do we also promote things that went right? Because a lot of times you stop and think, wow, the system's down for an hour, and you're like, you know, how could we let that happen? But then ultimately there's something there that lets you figure out how that was working. Maybe it was, you know, somebody logging into a box and finding some weird out-of-the-way metric. Well, that's great. Like, how can you surface that metric better to find that out in the future? Like, ultimately there's something that helped you fix this, and that was a good thing, you know, whether it's teamwork or whatever. But what can you do to reinforce that practice or that that thing that helped you. We do company-wide, well, anybody's welcome. Engineers usually show up these wide postmortems where you'll do the postmortem within your team or kind of your wider area. And then weekly, we do this production operations meeting where we'll present these postmortems. And they're kind of, in a way, celebrated. It's not so much in like a yay, we're down, but more, wow, these are things that we learned, and you know, somebody dug into this, and this is really worth other people learning. So we'll have everybody present, and people will pose questions, and a lot of times, you know, just getting the outside feedback of, oh, why this? Even though you thought about everything, just a complete outside opinion of why, and you're like, oh, well, actually that changes this quite a bit. So it's that learning, that extra feedback and everything. And it's just, again, to reinforce that, A, it's not somebody's fault that did this, like there was something broken in the system that allowed this to happen in the first place. And I guess classic recent example is like the Hawaii, you know, alert going off. Like, I'm sure that guy is fired, and I'm sure that button is probably still in the same place as somebody else is gonna fix or click in the future, rather than addressing like, why is that button even there? Why was it so easy to do? Any issues that come out of this, any actions from the postmortem, we regularly follow up in that meeting. So we'll tag in JIRA and just kind of like a reoccurring, like, has this been fixed, rather than just generating actions and they go flying off in the background. People forget about them. We keep following up to make sure they get fixed within a certain period. And as I mentioned before, a lot of these scenarios get replayed in game days. So a lot of the big ones, you know, if the website was down for a couple of hours, that's like a big deal financially, PR-wise, a lot of reasons. And usually the reason for that, or the reasons for that, were usually quite interesting, and it's nice to be able to replay those in the future in like a dev environment, or if we're confident enough in production again. And you know, to see like, has it actually been fixed, it's great. Especially when you get these wide systemic issues, it's great to say like, oh, we did these 20 actions across all these teams, but you don't really know if it actually addressed the issue. So if you try and repeat, like whether it's increasing traffic synthetically or actually, you know, just testing to see if the thing's actually fixed across their road. So we do a lot of iteration, lean practices. So we try and do the smallest thing we possibly can to prove a product theory. So that might not even be adding new code, it might be deleting code, or it might be taking something away from a user to prove it was valuable, or to prove that, you know, kind of the negative to show that it is useful. If there's a really thin, stupid way we can prove something, we'll do that first, even if it's not code. So we try and get that first usable product out there. You know, does it prove it, even again, like if it's for one route or like one region or whatever the smallest thing is that makes it easy. And if it's good, then we'll try and iterate on that. And it's a classic, you don't want to deliver everything in Big Bang. But then you also don't want to think that the smallest feature you're delivering is the best. I guess a good way to put it is you don't want to have to add on feature X, Y, and Z and think this is the smallest that we can deliver. You want to think, even if it's only one small thing, can we deliver that first to the user? And we try and keep the backlog as small as possible. So this applies that we don't want to sit there and think about things we're going to be working on in the future and it never comes to fruition, and we spend, you know, 2 weeks talking about it, and we've got reams of documentation, and it's just a waste of time. So yeah, small backlog. Try and keep the smallest thing possible out to the user to get value to them, to get feedback on our theory, and then just iterate on that. And a lot of that, again, is opened up by having these faster deployments because, you know, you take smaller changes. One of the smaller things, well, actually, I think it's quite big, but it's a small change. It's just like these engineering principles that we have. So we have some of these posters around. Which I can probably post another photo at some point. But it's just placed around the offices, and it kind of gets like a shared culture to get everybody to buy into this, to kind of guide us whenever we're building new tooling or whenever we're making new decisions for the engineering organization. It's just things like, a lot of things in our presentation, like, you know, we peer review things and we get things out as quick as possible, responsibly, you know, test things, and just a lot of the shared culture, just make sure, because it's up and we talk about it, we display it all over the place, it just kind of gets more buy-in for both people that have been there for a while to remind you, and new people coming in to work. Like, rather than just saying it once and forgetting about it, like, it's constantly brought up at the highest levels, you know, CTO on down, just to know that it's pretty important. So, developer user experience. I think this is something that a lot of places do it pretty poorly and don't really think about it as much and just aren't given the time for it. But I was shown in Skyscanner like how big of a change it makes to how you work and how you break apart problems. So we have several teams that are dedicated internally just to doing tooling, and it's a mix of like engineering and design. So not only do they do design related tooling, but then the designers also help them do the tooling for the engineering to make sure that it's something usable, not just like a client engineer type thing. We're their customers, so they always come to us and ask for new products, and they version things. They have kind of like a small backlog or roadmap. They get feedback, and they do all this as if we were any other customer. You know, they treat themselves as if they were building tooling for the general community, but it's just specific for Skyscanner and our needs, and we drive that. With all these things, I'm going to go over a few of the bigger parts here, but with all these together, you can get a new service from like literally no code to tests and, you know, with circuit breaking and distributed tracing and logging and metrics and everything else from nothing to production serving traffic within 5-6 minutes. It's just a couple of commands you can run. They have like a nice little interface, and it works real great. So the first part of that is mShell. It's like a microservice shell. It's a cookie cutter app that spits out a new service. So it's kind of like a template for a new service. They do one for language. They also do things like for Lambda and SAMZA, which is a data pipeline language in Java, and a couple other bits and pieces. So it's not just code, but anything internally that you might use. And it just spits out an empty project, gives you libraries, gives you like tests, gives you like a / enter code here, and a hello world test with a, you know, 1+1=true. But everything's wired up, everything's ready to go. You plug in your team name, the name of the project, and out pops this new project that's completely set up. Has some base Docker images, but it gives you, like out of here, like back pressure, circuit breaking, distributed tracing, logging, metrics. The test framework, it just gives you all this out of the box, ready to go. So it's not code sitting within your project, it's a lot of shared libraries. So the cookie cutter is a part of it, but a much smaller part. The bigger part is A, the standardization of the project template, the project layout, but then also the libraries that go into it, because each of those pieces I mentioned there are all separate libraries that, like I said before, are all versioned properly and all have, you know, their own kind of small roadmap for the future, and they all come to us for feedback. Like distributed tracing, when they first put it in, we just happen to use AWS X-Ray. If anybody's used that before, that's a great way to take a single request coming from the UI and see like all these services that it hit. And you know, they had like kind of an open all hands meeting, and they're like, what kind of features do we want from this, and what would work for us? That, you know, what are the commercial service providers use, or how can we tailor it? And they got all this together, and they said, okay, we're gonna start with like this very small bit, and we're gonna have it just for one project, and it worked great for that. They started rolling it out. And yeah, they've done it for all these bits, and they just start very thin, but they get it out there for everybody. And it's great, because when they release new features, everybody gets it at the same time. It's not like I have to go to project A, which has a completely different project layout and uses it a different way, and I can't upgrade it for whatever reason. And like all the usual kind of excuses you have for internal tooling and why one project is like 10 versions behind and never touched. With everybody being on the same page, it just kind of takes out a lot of those problems. Another piece is Slingshot, which is a zero-click deployment product that we wrote in-house. It's kind of a very thin wrapper. It just gives us target like agnostic deployment methods. So we're using, I think, at first they used EC2. Now we're using ECS. Kubernetes is coming up in the future, maybe Elastic Container Services at some point. It doesn't really matter what we're doing. The Slingshot gives you like a standard, it gives you like a YAML config and just says, I want to deploy this thing, you know, maybe public facing, so it needs API gateway, and maybe it needs authorization, and it just gives you a couple of options. I need this many CPU resources and memory, and it's just a very thin way to say, this is what I need, I don't really care where it's going, but like whatever I'm targeting, like this, these are my requirements, and it'll handle everything else for you. It does blue-green deploys, so it'll deploy your service to a new cluster, and it'll start slowly with the load balancer turning up traffic on it. You can define metrics to say, you know, if the error rate shoots up, if the latency shoots up, if this success rate from outgoing users drops, whatever you care about, you can just put in a OpenTSDB query, and you can say this thing changes outside these metrics, then I want you to roll it back. So it'll do it in small steps. It'll throw 1% of traffic on there, and this metric will look good. Okay, it'll ramp it up to 5%, and then I think it's like 30%, and 80%, and it's done. So this is all part of, when you commit to master, it goes through this, and you can define what metrics you care about. And because you're looking at metrics that your end user cares about, you're even more you're more sure that what's going out is still working. But it's not like, oh yeah, I'm working fine, but what I'm returning doesn't work with something else. My load balancer is actually returning garbage or timing out the end user. And I'm looking at their metrics my employ to make sure that whatever I push out is doing what I expect it to do. And it just gives a lot of consistency across the projects. So, it's not some build, deploy, batch file that everybody has. It's tweaked differently, and this project does this folder, this one does it this way. It's just a nice, consistent way that everybody follows. And they also provide a single managed cluster. So like I said up there, we're using IBCS right now. So if you don't have a good reason to not use it, you can just target this single cluster, and one squad part where you looks after it. They make sure it's healthy, they make sure it's well staffed, and it'll scale as needed. But it's just something that we don't have to touch. Each team doesn't need to manage your own cluster, update AMIs, and do all this other work that's associated. So the last one I want to talk about is CodeLift. It essentially just does automated project changes across all these different projects. So it'll crawl over projects, do some kind of action, and then it'll commit it as a merge request. The first thing that we use it for is debunk file versions. So all those libraries I was talking about before, like distributed tracing and logging and everything else, they're going to get a sync out of projects. People are not going to update them. CodeLift lets us go through all the projects, like each of the Git repos, and see, okay, this thing's on version 0.3.5, so the latest one's 0.3.6, so I'll commit it, and I'll actually push it directly to the team that owns that project or the merge request. So we can look over it, we can say, okay, everything works great, I'll merge it, boom, out to deployment, or out to production. And they're starting to trial auto-accepting these. So in the same way that Slingshot lets us do, blue-green deploys, and we put up 1% of users, does this work? They started with projects that we know have good test coverage and we know are quite stable, and it'll just bump the version, and it'll submit a merge request, automatically merge it, and write out in production without us touching anything. And they'll do it for one project, and okay, does it work? Great, let me try another couple of projects. And they put a lot of constraints on, say, only during business hours, and quite tight business hours that are like core across a lot of the different time zones. Teams have to opt into it, that they're kind of working a bit more of, how can they monitor projects work as we expect it to before we start going on to their projects. But just the idea of, one internal tooling team can release an update to a code library and automatically start pushing out code for everybody else to upgrade to make sure we're on the same version. It's really interesting. So a lot of things we can do with it. Maybe that library has code changes because the API is slightly changed. This code list go in there just because, again, we're all on standard project layouts. Maybe you can make whatever coding changes are required if it's possible. Security issues, we started using it for that to address, I think like in one of our libraries, we found an issue and there's a slight tweak. So we started doing this across projects to kind of tweak the security layouts to come in compliance and get that pushed out. And there's a lot of other things that they're looking to do with it. Surveyor is another tool at the Roadhouse that just kind of crawls over the projects and lets CodeLift know which projects it has to work on. So it lets you run queries like, for this given assembly, what version all the projects running on. And you can see when they first started, there was pretty much everything from version 0 to whatever the latest was and everything in between. So they started running CodeLift to get everybody. First it was manual, here's an email, your project's out of date, please update it. And now it's the point where we're starting to do it more automatically. But now we're down to everybody's upgraded within, I think, a week or two, the latest version. So it just kind of cuts down the internal developer enablement squads that do this. They don't have to think about versions that are, a year old kind of thing. They can just keep updating and everybody falls in the line. So is it perfection? It's definitely not. a lot of this, because I honestly really hate talks that make everything seem super rosy. You know, we have lots of skeleton in the closet, everybody does. A lot of this represents ideals that we're following now and we're backporting. We're not all the way there. I like to say we're about halfway there. Company-wide, some squads follow this 100%. Some are, you know, still catching up. We still have stuff at data centers that are not fully in AWS. We're going to be pushed to get out of this year. We're still working on slicing things and doing iterative development. You know, there's still plenty of projects that have fallen through and build this big Death Star before they get pushed out type thing, before they realize it's too late. But we're always trying to improve, and it's just constant iterative feedback and improvement. You know, it's a lot of retrospectives and, you know, what went well, what didn't go so well, what can we do to improve this next time, and just a little bit by a little bit, I think we're trying to get there. And I think this is probably the most important slide, is please don't just blindly copy all this. I definitely appreciate it. I didn't dive into details at all on this, so I was just trying to give an overview of what we did, kind of what your appetite. Ultimately, you know what works best for you and your situation. You know, don't just go out and start doing all this, because, you know, when you see Google and Facebook and all these other companies doing things, it's not right for you. You know, be inspired, maybe cherry pick a few of this, maybe start working towards this if you think it'll work. But yeah, just don't just blindly do it. So.
So yeah, that's it. I've got
an Darrell, a question.
Yeah.
How long did it take you to get used to adding random views and like favor, color, and all that kind of stuff?
Spell checker helps a lot.
Yeah.
When it's telling me, you know, it's wrong.
Yeah. I have a question.
Yeah.
The team that you were saying that kind of builds the shared templates and stuff like that,
yeah.
Do they also build? I know you talked about a Kubernetes cluster, and you've got, you know, this app with multiple apps, microservices and stuff. Do they help with like a dev environment, or is it really up to the dev? Like, if they need to run more than one of these services on their dev machine for testing it out and stuff?
They don't provide any direct tooling for that.
Okay.
So a lot of, especially the newer stuff that's relying on like gRPC. You can spin things up. You can use that same protocol definition to generate a service that's going to spit that out. So you can do it in your tests. A lot of people do keep things running in that sandbox environment, so not everything is torn down. Every 2 months, everything is completely wiped out, but maybe you have to wait half day if you're kind of relying on something to be there. You know, there's still a lot of services that do that. But the ideal is more and more that, yeah, the definition is set up front. So you just have to trust that it's doing what it is. You code your service, you push it out, and you just rely on metrics and the alerts and everything tell you what's working on that.
Cool. And then I think you mentioned there's a tool that actually does the deploy that was called?
That's a Slingshot.
Slingshot, yeah. So does that do like rolling deploys of containers that you said you're in ECS right now?